own journalist, KRAZTV. You know, over at the KRAZTV, it means keep real, A to Z, true vision. We have a playlist called Our New Chiefs, Our Strong Women. And yes, it's the book review today. And in that is one strong woman. Now, she knows several others, and I'll tell you the story as this goes along. It's called Vanishing Fleece. No puns, but if I do make a pun, it'll be only in jest and to humor it along. But that's the way it is. Adventures in American Wool. It's written by Clara Parks. And yes, there is an E there after her name. I hope she's going to watch this. Clara Parks presents a fast-paced account of the year she spent transforming a 676-pound bale of wool into commercial yarn and the people in the vanishing industry she discovered along the way. Well, that is true, and a real story it became. It is by Abrams Press, New York. Vanishing Fleece. Join Clara Parks on a cross-country adventure and meet a cast of characters that include shepherds, shearers, dyers, and countless mill workers, without whom our fields would be fallow, mills idle, knitting needles empty, and feet woefully cold. Travel a country with her as she meets a flock of Saxon Merino sheep in upstate New York, tours a scouring plant in Texas, sneaks inside the annual meeting of Big Wool, visits a steamy Maine dye house, helps sort freshly shorn wool fleece on a working farm, and learns how wool is measured, baled, shipped, and transformed into skeins. I hope I'm not butchering that name. In pursuit of knowledge and the perfect yarn, Parks adventures from Maine to Wisconsin, the most knitterly state, and back again. Along the way, she presents a behind-the-scenes look at the crazy complex workings of wool and the yarn-making industry in today's America. By the end of the book, you'll be ready to set aside the backyard chickens and add a flock of sheep instead. Isn't that be something? Simply put, no other book exists that explores our culture through the lens of wool. Well, it is a very narrow subject range, and that's good because she's a real expert at it. She has a degree in, textiles and all that. She did go to college and do her other exams, but she got hooked on fabrics, textiles, and she picked wool. Wouldn't that be nice? Stop. Anyways, she meets a guy named Eugene. He's an old man. I didn't know that. The way his vigor was and carrying on in this, she meets him, that he had 500 Merino, Saxon Merino. There's different kinds of Merino, but Saxon Merino has the very finest, and its wool is measured in microns, and some of it's way smaller than a hair. So its fleece really keeps you warm. As long as you don't get it wet when you're wearing it, it's as good as down or anything. But you keep the air trapped in it and fluff it up, though. But those are my little rants. These are not hers. But anyways, she just wanted to go and get around in the industry and meet people and stuff. And this guy's looking at her and talking and checking her out, you know, for a year and a half. And finally he says, I've got a bale. Would you like to do something with it? And she thought, wait a minute, that would be cool, because then we could do it from start to finish and go behind the scenes where nobody else has ever gone before, really, with an endeavor into looking at the life of the sheep and mostly about wool. So they cut off the wool, and then they have a thing called skirting where they get the crumbs and the feces and the crap around the edges of the sheep, and they don't take the top knot off the head or the around the legs and one other place. But anyways, this piece of wool all comes out looking like the sheep's body. Now, they need to be shorn in the spring before they lamb. And in the old days, I mean way back thousands of years ago, all sheep, naturally, it just came out in handfuls. It just fell off of them, you know, kind of like a snake shedding its skin. But relieving of the wool off of the animal is a natural process. Taking it off with shears is not cruel and unjust punishment or whatever. So anyway, then they take it and they classify it, then they bale it. And you can't get any water in there because it'll rot it while it's before it's being fixed. And so they bale it into big bale, 500 or more pounds, kind of like a cotton bale. And then they put these big wires to compress it down. And then she said, okay, and she took it. I don't know if she paid or... Then she said, well, because all this is going to cost and stuff, why not make this so other people are involved? She likes doing a lot of stuff herself, but she said, I'm going to spread the joy around a little. And so she made a Masters of Yarn. I think what it was, she called it a Masters of Yarn. I can't find it here. Anyways, she decided to start this Masters program. So she got people involved, and then people that wanted less involved but did want to be involved, they were called the Explorers. So she made a deal with them all, and they all threw in some money, and then she wrote up all the literature that they were going to need, and the notebooks, and the workshops, and all the meetings, and all this stuff. So it really got off to a good start. But then she had to do... So she got all that under her belt. Under her pelt. There you go, yeah. But anyways, then she started meeting people, and most of them were women. There are a few men in here, but mostly women were in the industry. So there's an old family, some of them that had the old mills. So then she met a couple of gals that bought some of the old mills back and carding machines. That teases, it's called teasing out. You pull it out. First, you got to clean it. But first, you got to scour it. So there's only a couple places in the United States, one or two left, where they actually pull all the junk out, blow out the stuff, and then they go through hot water vats and clean it. They don't, like, mash it or anything. They just let the water flow through it, and it cleans it all out. It's called scouring. And it reduces it by someone. And all this time, the 676-pound bale is going down in weight. So she's going to have a little bit less for each person in Skye, but it's going to be cleaned and perfect and merino wool, which is really fine stuff in the world. There's a place in there in the grading that becomes cashmere, so it's so fine. It's just wonderful. So then she goes and gets it to sort out. So it goes back to her place where she's working from. And they sort it into, first she cuts the bales, and of course it's under a lot of pressure, those wires, and it had to be cut with bolt cutters, stand aside, and go boom. So, and then it takes time to swell out. So the volume of the bale actually two or three times gets bigger. I don't want to give away too much in this book, but I want to give you a little synopsis of her adventures and stuff. So anyway, she divides it into four parts for four different mills, and then she sends one off to one and the other and ships them out. So they go through carding machines, and then they got to go through roving, where it makes it like a strand, but it's thick and soft, and when you pull on it, it doesn't have any strength. Then it goes down into twisting, to where it twists into one or two or whatever. And then there's plies, and then you put those all together to make it stronger and to make a bigger weave. And so then it gets into the yarn. Then she's got some yarn. Well, she wants to dye some of it. So she goes to dye houses, and they have natural dyes, a woman from India in Oakland, I think she had to go to Oakland. And people work out of their homes or little places near their house that's like a small workshop, because it's really a very small industry. And it is dying out. They said 1% of all wool in the world comes from the United States. And in all of synthetic and all fabrics and everything used, 1% of it is only wool. So U.S. wool is way down there in production and all of that. But it's because it got taken away. 150 years ago, this place was screaming with wool mills. And a lot of stuff that went into England was cotton mills. So nowadays, she's taken all the wool to the dye houses, and she's gone to small mills where they use antiquated, and there's one that has an old, it's called a Mueller, and it's built in the 1800s, and there's only one left that's working. There's no parts. They have to make parts or have old machinery that they get the pieces off and cannibalize and salvage and whatnot. So it's a fascinating story, and it's people that are really dedicated to the industry. And Parks is one of these people, and so she knows a lot of people in the industry, and people like her, I think. I'm sure she is. She gets a punish around them, so some like her puns. That's the reason why I'm carrying on with the puns, because she makes a big deal out of the puns in here, so puns to you. Anyway, she has other mills, and then she takes one load to a large commercial mill. Now, the difference in the length in, like English sheep, it's long fibers, and then in merino, it's short fibers. I guess the short's better, but the machinery has to match the size of the fiber, and so they had a little bit of a time trying to adapt their machinery, because one bale is a couple days' work or a day or few hours to them in these big mills, and you know they do hundreds of thousands of pounds in a year, and she's only got 600, and the bale that part that she sent was only 168. She said, "Time that come out of there." Oh, they're called worsted. She had to go to a worsted mill, and there they mix fabrics with it. I mean, like cotton or silk. So the advantage with the silk and all is it really grabs some color and pops out. Some of the older guys like Eugene was saying that they were garish colors. But by the time they got done, she had some garish colors, but she got the natural colors and browns and all that. I know I'm carrying on. It's 12 minutes. I've never done a book report for as little a book as this. But we got this book at the Tucson Public Library. Of course, Eugene died in... It was a sad scene on that, but I'm not going to go. You have to read the book. But she made a lot more friends, and she fulfilled her obligations, and everybody got their skeins of wool. And at fairs, they say these certain dyers and people like that, the minute the door opens, they all run, boom, right over there to their booth, take it all up, and in 5 minutes or less, all the wool for that year is gone. Gone, sold out to the people that are aficionados and the ones that really want this fine fleece and special colors. And dye makers are as famous as winemakers. I know I'm a winemaker and I'm not famous. Anyways, I'm going to get back to fleecing y'all with a story here. Thanks for watching KRAZTV, and get the book like I did at your library. It's called Vanishing Fleece, Adventures in American Wool. That's her on the back of the sheet. Roping with yarn. And it's Clara Parks, isn't she?